Rock and roll doggy.
Sort of a musical journey, really.
That's good. I wasn't worried about it.
No, it's a musical journey.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Rock and Roll Doggies. It's Jason and Don. We are two lifelong friends breaking down music that's been important to us. We're walking through U2's catalog, album by album, track by track, and we're right in the middle of No Light on the Horizon. We have just finished going through, and we stopped right about Get On Your Boots. So we are ready for track 7. We're talking about stand-up comedy. I like it. I like all the self-deprecating lines. I like when he says small men with big ideas. He's trying to make sure people know he gets the joke. He's a small child crossing an 8-lane highway on a voyage of discovery. This whole ego, all of this stuff. I like this song. I think it's a good bounce back out of Get On Your Boots. And it's this big, kind of this middle section where, you know, there are Unknown Caller and I'll Go Crazy. Those are almost, those just kind of run together. Get On Your Boots is like the middle axis of the album that separates the back half. And this is a, like the beginning of, I don't know, where side two would be if we were doing a cassette. But I think this is kind of turning a corner on the album and saying, okay, it's getting a little bit different in terms of theme. What do you think?
I would actually liken this one more to I'll Go Crazy If I Don't Go Crazy Tonight for me, because I break it down with Get On Your Boots, which is a good kind of a good separator between those two songs on the album. You know, it's a song that I think a lot of U2 fans have really disregarded, and a track that they tend to think is a pretty weak track. I disagree. I think it's catchy. There's a line, though, and this would be in contention for the lyric, the best line of the album, and that is, "Stop helping God across the road like a little old lady."
Fantastic.
I just love that.
Mm-hmm.
And I like it. It originally featured mandolins playing a Middle Eastern beat to start the song. But again, I think they were too afraid to go too far off the beaten path.
I'd like to hear that.
Yeah, would too. They seem so immersed in this Middle Eastern culture while they were recording this. And then the final product is not really very Middle Eastern at all. I mean, I don't want it to be too far out there, but
right.
I would like something a little bit more ambitious.
Yeah, I want more of that flavor. There's some great lines in here, though. The reflecting on being a rock star when it's walking the tightrope. The line is stretched in between the two towers. It's like a, you know, the rock star lifestyle is like walking a tightrope, or the DNA lotto. That's a
I like that one. Yeah.
It's kind of funny.
DNA lotto may have left you smart. Yeah.
Well, and here's one too. This is a kind of a transitional line, but while I'm getting over certainty, that's right before stop helping God. It's kind of a throwaway, but while I'm getting over certainty, stop helping God across the road.
Yeah.
Think about that. While I'm getting over certainty, that's a great little line for me personally, because so much of my life has been changing or deconstructing what I had taken as certainty in my upbringing, and then redefining what I think is my own personal belief, but that I didn't take automatically as certainty, breaking it down and building it back up again. I was getting over certainty, because when I was 15, I was certain of a lot of things that maybe shouldn't have been. I like that, and never even noticed it until much later after this album came out.
Eno said this about the song, and again, this harkens back to what I mentioned in Moment of Surrender a little bit. It can be frustrating at times when they sometimes take a song and work it into the ground and then work it back to life again. That's what's happened with stand-up comedy. I was thinking the other day, and this is obviously some time ago, I was thinking the other day that Edge had probably heard that song more than even the most dedicated U2 fan ever will.
They worked so much on it.
Then they brought it back to where they probably close to where they had it originally.
Your line that "stop helping God across the road like a little old lady." That's a great line. Another one is "God is love. Love is evolution's very best day." That's a great line.
Definitely.
I love it. It means a lot to me. This song has a great guitar sound again. I mean, yes. When Edge has the chance to create on this album throughout, he makes it sound really good. This guitar is hot. It works. I think this is, like you said, it's almost like these two songs, "I'll Go Crazy" and "Stand Up Comedy" on either side of "Get On Your Boots," they bookend maybe a weak, weird song with two more solid tracks.
Let's listen to a little bit of this one. I gotta stand up and take a step. You and I have been asleep for hours. I gotta stand up. The wire is stretched in between our two towers. Stand up in this dizzy world where we're lovesick. I can steal the view. Not gonna fall down if I can stand up. Can I stand up to beauty, dictator of the heart? I can stand up for hope, faith, love. But while I'm getting over certainty, stop helping God across the road like a little old lady.
That is Stand Up Comedy, U2. It's Rock and Roll Doggies with Don, and I'm Jason. We're talking about U2's No Line on the Horizon. And I like the little line in here, soul rocking people moving on. I didn't understand that, you know, for a long time. But then you're like, that's kind of cool. And it's very groovy. Soul rocking people moving on. It's just a very cool little line in there. And "We're Made of Stars" is a line in this song, kind of like Moby, "We're All Made of Stars."
That's an interesting take. I'd never put those two together.
Yep. So Stand Up Comedy, the DNA lotto may have left you smart.
Stand up, then sit down for your love. There's a lot of meat in this song, really.
I don't know why
people sometimes bash it. It's not where the streets have no name, but it's far from Miami.
I like how we've got now another way to measure bad reference. Songs. We're like, no, it's not Miami, but it's Kissimmee.
Yeah.
Like, measure how bad a song is by how far into South Florida it is.
Yes.
It's Tallahassee. Yeah.
It's a geographical analysis, comparison.
This is Rock and Roll Doggies, and it's time for a short break. We'll be right back. And now back to Rock and Roll Doggies.
Track 8, Fez Being Born, another song with a fairly lengthy intro. Another song that I think was fairly ambitious, rightly or wrongly. It's a song that has only 13 lines, and the song goes for over 5 minutes. So there's a lot of music here, but there's not a lot of lyrical content. And I think for the music, and you can argue for whether that's for better or for worse, carries the song because there's not a lot of lyric here.
Sure.
It's almost like an instrumental track. It's almost like Promenade or MLK in a way, just from that perspective. Do you like this one?
I love it. I think
really,
okay. Yeah, I've always loved it. The sounds, okay. The sounds are really cool. It's got the Moroccan sound. This is like the really the only song that reflects that whole the environment they were in. That's like, oh yeah, it was recorded in Morocco. I get it. It has a lot of, you know, Middle Eastern sounds. It has a lot. I like the changes and like the way it goes from this kind of thing to that. I like the way the song evolves. It really takes me to that other place. Okay. With kind of that imagery. There's so few lyrics, but they're really cool. And they're just there to take you to another place. It does sound like Promenade. It just names random things like,
right, Coca-Cola football radio.
Coca-Cola football radio. Yeah. You know, and so this is 6 o'clock on the auto route, burning rubber, burning chrome. It goes through this whole, it's just painting a picture. It's a sketch of this.
Yeah, it is a sketch. You're right.
Yeah. It sets this mood unlike anything else does. But then it does also bring in the idea of being born a bleeding start. And I think we mentioned that it was like this being sort of a theme on the album of being born or going back to childhood, going back to being an infant. Oh, my first cry was a
joyful noise. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know what this song means, and I'm fine with that.
The only way I know to break down what it means is to go to the source, because when you look at the lyrics, again, we're dealing with something that's arcane. It's very difficult to look at some of this stuff and really go, oh yeah, that's what it means to me.
Yeah.
You just quite succinctly put it that I don't really know what it means, but I like it.
Yeah.
And that's not something we've said a lot in these podcasts, because we break this stuff down, but we get to this album and yeah, I kind of like it. I don't particularly care for it, but I don't really know what it means.
But
to me, or from the artist's perspective.
Then you think about what's the purpose of music. I mean, it's communicating something, but it's also making you feel.
Yeah,
something.
Right. Yeah. Jazz music, for example.
Right. Yeah. So what is that song about? Dude, you got to feel it.
Yeah.
The engine's roar, blood curling wail, head first, then foot, the heart set sail. I don't know. It's cool.
This was actually considered, believe it or not, for a while to open the album.
That would have set a different tone. It's I do believe in track order setting.
Oh my gosh, yes.
Right?
Oh yes, it's an art.
Yeah.
You're telling a story.
It used to be a different art when we had two sides, you know, on a cassette,
right,
on an album.
Right. Yeah.
But still, it is. Fez Being Born, I like. It's one of my favorite songs on this album. Top.
I'm surprised. I mean, I'm not surprised that you like it more than I do. That's just kind of a gut feeling that I had. Let me throw this out there though. Bono stayed in 2009, because I mentioned this earlier about what the artist may have meant. This guy on a motorcycle, a Moroccan French cop who's going AWOL. He drives through France and Spain down to this village outside of Cadiz, where you can actually see the fires of Africa burning.
Wow.
I don't know how anyone could read the lyrics of this song and come to that conclusion unless you wrote the song.
Yeah, unless it happened to you.
Right.
You were the guy. By the way, Cadiz or Cadiz, that is not the same place as the Cadiz,
no, it's,
Kentucky.
No, it's not. I think it's Cadiz in
Cadiz.
Western Kentucky, in Trigg County.
Trigg County, baby.
Yeah.
That's kind of like, well, what are you doing? You're writing a song about something none of us could have known what that is. But again, it's a painting. It's like a picture.
Yeah,
like,
you're right. It's a sketch. You're right. That's a good way to put it.
Let me in the sound, baby. Let me in the sound. Let me in the sound.
This is a track I skip over. I do not listen to this track.
Wait.
Track 9, I do listen to.
Hold on. You skip Fez?
No, we were talking about Fez.
I know. You're saying the next one. Talking about Fez Being Born. Do you skip that track?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's weird. I mean, I look forward to it so much. Okay, moving on. We're on track 9. White as Snow. This is so well written. Such a great, lovely, haunting description of growing up literally and spiritually, figuratively. I don't even need to know if this is about a real person, about Bono and his brother Norman, right? Or about just some story. It just really takes you there. Right. It takes you to that place where he knew, once he knew there was a love divine, then came a time I thought it knew me not. Bro, what a great line. Who can forgive forgiveness where forgiveness is not? Only the lamb as white as snow.
It's like we talked about that. The band, I think, had this original idea, and I'm sure it changed upteen times. But that they were going to try to write an album of hymns.
Mm-hmm.
This would have been a hymn, a modern rock hymn.
Mm-hmm. And even though it's slow and it kind of comes between two, maybe my two favorite songs on the album, I don't skip it because it is, I like that feeling that it gives off. It's so, trying to find a better word than haunting. But you know what I'm talking about. Listen to this. Let's listen to the White as Snow.
Who can forgiveness where forgiveness is not? Only the land as white as snow. At all.
poppies laugh under a crescent moon. The road refuses strangers, the land, the seeds we sow. Where might we find a land as white as snow? As boys we would go hunting in the woods to sleep the night, shooting out the stars. Now the walls are every passing stranger, every face cannot know. If only your heart could be as white as snow. If only your heart could be as white as snow.
It is White as Snow from No Line on the Horizon. Jason and Don, Rock and Roll Doggies. Any thoughts on what this song is truly about, Don?
Well, again, you know, he's writing third person, as he has done at other times on this album, and he will do it again on the closing track. I think it's about a dying soldier in the Middle East, and I think the key line is, and the water, it was icy and it washed over me. That tells you that he's dying and he's having this bit of epiphany about his past spiritual doubts, and those have been brought now to the forefront because of his, where he is now. He's dying in a war, and he begins to see, I think, the world in a much different light. If only a heart could be as white as snow.
Yeah.
That's a statement of innocence, not a statement of being jaded. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a transition that occurs in this song because of that.
I agree. He's not saying a heart can't be, I can't get forgiveness or absolution.
Right.
If right. only. So it's a longing. Again, it's like the psalmist, right? You said something interesting. You said he's writing in third person. He's actually writing in first person, but he's pretending to be someone.
Well, right. Correct. You're right. Right. Right.
Which is, he's saying, I am doing these things, but he's
right. You're right. Right.
Is there something that specifies that it's a soldier? Did I miss that lyric?
It As fits. Boys, we would go hunting in the woods to sleep the night, shooting out the stars. Now the wolves are every passing stranger. So I think that's where you infer that.
Yeah.
The song was actually inspired by Pincher Martin, which was a William Golding book. William Golding wrote Lord of the Flies, not to be confused with Lord of the Rings.
Do you think people confuse those two books?
Just by title only. The thing that sticks out in Lord of the Rings, where they're always making fun of the fat kid with asthma. I don't know why that always stuck in my mind, but
because that's what kids do, man. Wait, in Lord of the Flies.
Yeah.
Did I say Lord of the Rings? It was the fat kid in Rings.
Right. It was right.
Yeah.
Lord of the Flies, yeah. See, now I'm getting them confused.
So White as Snow. I didn't know. So what's that story about, or that book about, that?
I don't know. I only read one William Golding book, and it was Lord of the Flies. I saw the movie, so I can't. No, I think it was a similar story about a soldier in war and blah, blah, blah. But I don't know anything more.
Yeah. Well, I think this song is lovely. I like it. It hits my ears right, and it hits my emotions right. And to me, I roll right through. Again, I'm not skipping anything on this album, even if I don't think it's that strong. I always look forward to the last few tracks on this album because I don't know, they're so strong.
I agree. Yeah, I agree.
White as Snow.
By the way, the French horns are in this song. We talked about
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is really good stuff.
You probably know this, but the musical arrangement in the verse, there's no chorus, but it's based loosely on O come Emmanuel. So that. Yeah. Put that in your brain and then overlay that with White as Snow and you'll see a relationship.
Wow. Okay. I'm going to think about that. This is Rock and Roll Doggies, and we will be right back. And now, back to the show. Okay, to you, sir.
Track 10, which I know is a song that you hold in high regard, a song with a nice little cello intro, a song that Brian Eno said at the time was U2's best song ever. A song that reminds me a little bit of Tom Petty's Jamming Me.
Ooh.
It is track 10, Breathe.
How can he not like this song? It is just
kicks live.
It is so good. And I remember when they sang it on the David Letterman show. Do you remember they had like a week?
Yeah, they were on
every night.
Yeah.
And they sang this one. This is the best thing here, I think, on this album. It's such a smart ass and still kind of, you know, in on the joke kind of thing. The long line of traveling salespeople. I mean, this
cockatoo.
It is. It's a cockatoo. Come on. This is, to me, the best thing on the record. The fun parts, the rapid fire parts, the guitar is so satisfying. I just love that little lilt of these days are better than that. These days are better than that.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're trying to make a statement all the way through this album, and they don't always succeed on, you know, Move to Trash, you know, it like, but this one, this
They're
track,
there. They
succeed.
Arrive. Yeah.
Yeah. These days are better than that. Every day I die again and again, I'm reborn. Every day I have to find the courage to walk out in the street with arms out. Got a love you can't defeat, neither down nor out. Come on.
It's like I had this image sometimes when I hear this song about someone who is, they're trapped in constrictive clothing and they just rip the clothing off and they're liberated. They're no longer constrained and they're able to move around and kind of be who they are.
Huh.
The last part of this song are just fabulous. Walk out into the sunburst street. Sing your heart out. Sing my heart out. I found grace inside a sound. I found grace. It's all I found, and I can breathe now. That stuff is up there with a lot of really good U2 songs.
That's one of the best phraseology.
Yes.
That's one of the best phrasings ever that U2 has ever put together and sung. And it somehow the music also sounds liberating to where you feel like, did he just take off his coat because he sounds free, like you said?
Yeah. It reminds me a little bit of Magnificent in that it has that jubilant, liberating feel.
Here's something I didn't know for a long time, though. The 16th of June, it's not just random, it seems, that is what the novel Ulysses by James Joyce, famous Irishman. The novel Ulysses takes place over one day in Dublin on June 16th, 1904. So I don't know what thematically that has, you know, to say about the song, other than just maybe a wink toward his fellow countrymen.
It's I like the coming down with some new Asian virus, and obviously before 2020, that's a throwaway phrase.
Yeah,
but coming out of what we went through, like says 16th of June, Chinese stocks are going up, and I'm coming down with some new Asian virus. That's almost prophetic.
It is.
It's crazy.
And, I mean, we had bird flu. We had other kinds of things that were, but it sounded so exotic and so weird. And we all know how it felt in 2020. That almost sounded prophetic. I've got a quote from New Music Express. "Breathe is unspectacular on first listen, but later proves itself perhaps the best song they've written since Stuck in a Moment You Can't Get Out Of." It's a pummeling foray into blues rock, all crashing chords and a soaring chorus with the simple call to walk out into the street, sing your heart out. The verse, the verse is twaddle. So I guess that's a British word for not good. Although they do like the line, coming from a long line of traveling salespeople, "On my mother's side, I wasn't just going to buy anyone's cockatoo." So I do love the way he says that. That's pretty badass. It is patently, again, this is from New Music Express, patently old school, U2 ridiculous. But the Edge's nuclear guitar solo is why it sounds so heart-stirringly brilliant. Big praise from some people about this track. Again, I think whatever the rest of the album is like, this song is worth it.
Yeah, it's, you know, I think it's grown on me more. I know you've loved it from the get-go. I've liked it, but I've developed a deeper sense of appreciation. And I think it's because I've dug into the lyrics a little bit more. I like the idea. It's not only about the idea that it's liberating and you can exhale and so forth, breathe, but it's the rejection of what society is cramming down your throat. Mm. I'm not going to buy just anyone's cockatoo.
Yeah.
These days are better than that. Why would I invite a complete stranger into my home?
Yeah. And this stranger is very confident of actually exactly what I need. I mean, we've all heard millions of sales pitches and late night TV. Here's the one thing you need in your life. And there's one simple trick, one weird thing, right? And all the stuff. I think you're right. He's responding to all the noise. Three things I need you to know.
Yeah, three things I need you to know. Coming from a lot, and then he goes on about this guy showing up trying to sell him a bird. And then why would I invite this guy selling a bird into my house? These days are better than that.
Days are better than that.
Which is a nice line too. It's not heavy, but I like the insertion there.
The appearance on TV on the Letterman show was also very memorable. A lot of times we attach that to how much we like the song. That's always stuck with me as the album was just coming out. I thought that was a pretty bold performance and I liked it a lot. I don't even remember what else they sang during that week where they were on every single night, but Breathe stuck with me.
What would have been your lead track on this album?
Magnificent. I mean, it's the safest bet.
Yeah, I tend to agree.
And it's kind of like open the album with what you know people are going to, and it's the single that's released to radio too. That's what I would have done.
I just didn't know. I asked that question wondering if you might be inclined to open, because they open the shows with Breathe.
Yeah.
On the 360 tour. And I just didn't know, with you being such a fan of this song, if you would have stuck it in the,
I don't think so. Track. Somehow it works as like a closing statement.
Yeah, it really does. Yeah.
Like a journey that's now we're here. We started out back here at this confusing kind of meandering.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Although it might have even been, it's track 10 and not track 11. Piggybacking on what you just said, it might be better as track 11, but I don't know what you do with track 11, because it kind of, I don't know, track 11 may be misplaced. It's and we're getting ahead of ourselves, but U2 doesn't, they don't typically close out albums like with a song like Breathe. I mean, it's 40, it's Wake Up Dead Man, it's
right.
Mothers of the Disappeared, it's what, Love is Blindness. Yeah. They bring it back down at the end of an album. So
this is Rock and Roll Doggies, and we'll be right back. And now, back to the show.
They bring it back down at the end of an album. So,
which is what they do here. And that's why I think it never occurred to me to change the order of songs on this album. I like the ending with that quietness. Maybe it's because, like you said, we've seen it so many times. So like, and it's an afterthought. I think it's a nice quiet way to close out the album, but it's not White as Snow. That's also quiet, but this is haunting, right? Let's go ahead and go to track 11. This is Cedars of Lebanon.
Yesterday I spent asleep. Woke up in my clothes in a dirty heap. Spent the night trying to make a deadline. Squeezing complicated lives into a simple headline. I have your face in an old Polaroid. Tidying the children's clothes and toys. You're smiling back at me, I took the photo from the fridge. Can't remember what then we did. Haven't been with a woman, it feels like, for years. Thought of you the whole time, your salty tears. This shitty world sometimes produces a rose. The scent of it lingers. Then it just goes.
Such a picture, right? Why don't you talk about it first?
The more I've listened, it's a little bit like Breathe, in that the more I've listened to this song, the more I appreciate it. There's a lot. It's maybe the most textured song on the album, and it's, that sounds kind of strange for a song that's very acoustic, but you know, you hear the synthetic sound of helicopters flying, and then you hear the person repeating verbiage in with a Middle Eastern accent, and this is all kind of textured. Again, you know, it's like they kind of stuck their toe in being adventurous, but they didn't. This would have been a really nice track to have done that with. But I really like this one, and I think it's, like I said, it's grown on me more as I've listened to it. I like the lyrical transition here. He says, child drinking water from a dirty bank, a soldier brings oranges he got out from a tank. And then all of a sudden it's, I'm waiting on the waiter, he's taking a while to come. I love that change of pace.
Yeah.
It brings you back to realizing that there's someone in a specific place and time who's telling you these things are going on, which is what a correspondent does.
Yes, exactly. And it's such a specific little details. I love that when the waiter is taking a while.
Because we all say those kind of things.
Yeah, right. And he's just watching the stuff around him.
So, yeah. He's observing.
So it's definitely the journalist who is... it's a stab at maybe at the media, maybe not the media, but more like the world we live in, that we hear about people dying as if they're numbers. We're squeezing complicated lives into a simple headline. These are individuals with lives. They lead complex lives, just as complex and interesting as our own. And yet we have to squeeze these complicated lives into a simple headline. And is that a byproduct of the way we have to consume our information, I guess, but it's the reality. And that's what this journalist is tasked with, this rich life around him and these tragic occurrences of these people, the things that are happening. This is a very complex situation, obviously, in the Middle East and in the part of the world where we only struggle to understand ancient situations. All we can have is a headline.
It's cedars, right, by the way, in that part of the world, were often mentioned as a gift from God and a source of wealth for Lebanon. And there are multiple. David used it, cedar wood, when he built his palace. So there is a, there's a biblical link to the title of the song, of which is, we've seen that numerous times so far in this album. It's also, parenthetically, a state park in north central Tennessee. There's a Cedars of Lebanon State Park in northern Tennessee. That's the most useless piece of information to come out of this podcast.
Oh, that's pretty good. I think that I like the details too of, there's a picture of his wife or former wife or partner.
Oh yeah, I like that. Yeah.
And he remembers exactly what was happening that
day. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And he took that photo from the fridge.
It but was I can't a picture remember of her. What we did after that.
Yeah. She was tidying the children's clothes and toys. I don't know what happened after that, but like those things are so interesting. All right. I love remembering things in those. It's like, I remember like my son writing and we're saying, oh, about the sexy boots, little things like that. This one's more interesting than mine. Return the call to home. You think maybe that you hear that throughout, but it only is said twice. This line repeats twice throughout the song. It's the closest that there is to like a chorus. And it's the only line in the song that's sung instead of spoken, right?
Oh, nice observation.
It's also sung in harmony. It's like two-part or two-part harmony.
It's edge. And
which makes it, And it's so lithe, L-I-T-H-E. So the narrator is embedded in a country as a war correspondent, and he admits he does not want to go home, but he also seems haunted by the memories of his family. We can just feel that. So the line of return the call to home could mean that he's missed the call from his family, needs to call him back, but it could be figurative that he needs to return home. He's got a head like a lit cigarette. Great line. Because you know it is hot as hell over there.
Yeah.
So it's also fatigue and mental stress and anxiety and all of that. But
choose your enemies carefully because they will define you.
Yeah. What do you think that's about?
The relationship that you have with your enemies may define you as much as the relationship you have with your friends.
Keep your friends close and your enemies closer.
Yeah. Yeah.
Derivative of that, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Love your enemies.
So I do like this song a lot, Cedars of Lebanon.
It's different. It's a lot different than his writing in this is a lot different. Like a lot of songs on this album, I think, I don't know if I'd have to go back and look, but you know, like you said, there's no chorus there.
Mm-hmm.
And for someone who doesn't write in this style, I think he really does a great job of writing, particularly as we've talked about that transition. And he throws out, I have your face in an old Polaroid, tidying the children's clothes and toys. You're smiling back at me. I took the photo from the fridge. Those are really insignificant in a sense. Taken by itself, it's insignificant. But when you put it into a song, it really helps to paint a much broader picture about what the song's about. Mm-hmm. It kind of evokes a much better image of what this guy's going through than it would be if you just left that alone. You go, so what? Your wife took a picture and there's some kids in it, big deal.
Mm-hmm.
But that's it, it's bigger than that.
And it shows how important it is to that person. Here's this soldier, and he remembers every detail about this thing, this sacrament that he's got, this photo. I said soldier, I meant not a soldier, he's a war correspondent, but still, like, he's in a place that is not a happy place, and he's got this thing that reminds him of happier times, and he remembers so much about it to the nth degree. Things about your life that are such happy memories, you remember things that are minutia.
Yeah.
That rounds it out. That is track 11, Cedars of Lebanon. It's Rock and Roll Doggies. We are doing No Line on the Horizon from you two, and I'm ready to talk about the summary of the album, Don. How you
Let's roll.
Ready for that? Let's do it. it seems like this was a muddled attempt at a whole different thing. Some safe moments, some new ground. I think there's more good than not good. Again, no skips for me. I will go ahead and ask you for your standout track on No Line on the Horizon. What is it?
I think it came down to Moment of Surrender and Magnificent. And I just think the songwriting is a little better on Moment of Surrender. So that's my standout track.
Gotcha. Yeah, no argument there. I've got Moment of Surrender, and it's in a solid tie with Breathe. If I had to pick one, we haven't done ties in these awards, have we? I would say Moment of Surrender, but I could also say Breathe just as easily. Those are the top two tracks for me. Standout track, Moment of Surrender, we agree on.
What's your underrated track?
Underrated track is Cedars of Lebanon.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's a solid choice.
Right?
Yeah.
It's just, again, such a picture. Who hasn't felt like yesterday I spent asleep, woke up in my clothes in a dirty heap? Oh my God, I've been to college. I know. But like, there's so many little things in that song that just make it stand out. And it's more appreciated than just a quiet way to end the album. I could have picked a couple of others I think are not given their due, but that's mine.
We've established that it's Cedars of Lebanon.
It's that one. I think that Fez Being Born might not be appreciated as much.
Okay.
Should be.
Okay.
Yeah.
For me, White as Snow.
No argument.
I think it's an emotional song, really.
Musical.
And it's a lot like the production of the song. There's some really nice snippets of lyric there. Like Years Instead of Days is one that I think we overlook, that, you know, speaks kind of how quickly time flies, particularly to a dying man.
Yeah.
And since I asked you what your second choice would be, my second choice would be, if it's up for this award, I would go with No Line on the Horizon.
Yeah, that's good. I mean,
was it nominated? Can I vote on it? If it was, would that be qualified as a potential?
What's that?
Would that be up for underrated track? I mean, would it, in other words, we know that Moment of Surrender wouldn't be an underrated track because it's well received.
Oh, I see.
No Line on the Horizon, well received enough that it wouldn't qualify. It's like too many at bats to be Rookie of the Year.
I mean, how do you define most underrated? By who? By
right.
People
it's
we
so
know.
Arbitrary.
But I guess that means we couldn't have nominated I'll Go Crazy because that was up for Song of the Year.
You have a point. It's like nominating one for underrated track, you know.
Yes, everyone thinks it's awesome, but not awesome enough.
We're going to surprise you here. What's your best lyric?
So
I think you kind of hat tipped that earlier.
I did hat tip. Yeah. So there's three that I'm going to mention, and I'll tell you which one is going to be the best.
Okay.
It's not If I Believe in Love, if love believes in me.
Mm.
That is just outstanding. Stop helping God across the road like a little old lady.
Mm.
Outstanding. And my choice for best lyric, my favorite, is God is love and love is evolution's very best day. What is your choice for best lyric?
Struggle with it, but only love can leave such a mark, but only love can heal such a scar. I like the idea that love can be a source of, it kind of serves a dual purpose. It's an indication, the mark is an indication of pain and suffering, but the scar is an indication of redemption from the pain and suffering. So I like the duality there in that statement.
Yeah, pretty cool. I also thought, I remembered you talking about, I found grace inside a sound. I found grace. That's all
yeah.
I found.
Yeah. Yeah.
As being a favorite lyric of yours. And that's also, when you think about this album, there's a lot of inconsistency, or that, you know, not everything works on it, but there's a lot more that I pull out lyrically on this album than I do the previous two. And I don't know why that is, but that informs my rating of the album. Okay. So like, is it, I don't know. I listen to it more. I enjoy it more than the previous two. And I know it wasn't as popular or as well received critically, but still I get a lot more out of it. And maybe it's how many lyrics we can name that could have been the best one, right?
Yeah. I think the songwriting, I would have to kind of compare them both at the same time, but I think the songwriting is better on this album than it was the previous album. This album suffers in that it lacks a lot of, I keep using this term, but it's lacks cohesion and it lacks focus. It's as if, and I may have mentioned this earlier, that it's almost like ambiguity is the theme of the album. I think it loses itself in that, and the lyrics probably are underappreciated because they're just some kind of weird moments
they're
in this
obtuse.
Album. But I agree. I think I thought that too when I was looking back on this. Is, man, there's some nice little snippets of lyrics.
I think there are four or maybe five top tier songs on this album.
Yeah.
Moment of Surrender, Breathe, Fez Being Born to me is a top tier, and Cedars of Lebanon.
So you wouldn't put Magnificent up there with those?
Magnificent. Yeah.
Okay.
Five. I think that, you know, arguably there are five and there are certainly three. So, you know, when I compare it to, and everything we do on here, I'm like, going to give it a rating, but what did I give the other ratings, you know, for the other albums? Yeah. I don't think there's five top tier songs on All That You Can't Leave Behind. I don't think there's five on Atomic Bomb. There's no,
it's a different, you know, they were obviously looking for more mainstream success with All That You Can't Leave Behind and Atomic Bomb. And then they were willing to sacrifice some of that for No Line on the Horizon. And I think lyrically, they got most of the way there. And some having, you know, some really critically acclaimed, critically received good songwriting. But, you know, there's some weak moments.
Yeah.
Kind of almost like the lyrics are really good at times, but the songs that encapsulate those, that house those, really at times aren't that great.
It's interesting because you're right, but I still don't skip songs. And skipping is kind of a indication we use of sometimes how much you like an album.
Yeah.
Listen, I'm going to skip Sometimes You Can't Make It on Your Own. I'm going to skip that every time because I don't always want to hear that, what that is. It's just too much, right? And it's just like too much to, I want to experience that. It's almost like I don't want to have a T-bone steak every meal.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. And that's a flawed analogy in so many ways. And that might not make the final cut of this podcast, but anyway, so all those reasons lead me to give my rating.
Let me give you, before you do that, let's update the leaderboard.
You almost said the score. You think it's a score.
Through 11 albums, you have an average album score of 8.7, and I have one with 8.5. So,
okay,
for those people that are keeping track at home.
Okay. I predict that I'm going to rank this one higher than you.
Okay.
I give this a 9.0. And this is based on how much I enjoy it, you know, more so than how good I think it is, how successful I think it is, how well it does what it set out to do. That's not my yardstick. I'm using how much I enjoy it.
So for reference, that means it is on par for you with All That You Can't Leave Behind. It is we're splitting hairs. It's a tenth of a point less than Pop. It is
same as War.
A tenth of a point higher than The Unforgettable Fire. It is, you gave War a 9, so it's on par with War.
Yeah. I'm happy with that.
Okay. Okay. I get it was 7.9.
Oh, wow.
So for me, it is on par with, it is 3/10 of a point higher than War. And I don't think there's anything else. It's 0.3 of a point lower than Zooropa.
Wait a minute. You gave War a 7.6?
Yeah.
What? Are you sure?
No, I'm sure. Yeah, I believe that.
That's crazy. I don't remember that being so low.
So that brings the updated tally.
Gee.
Puts you now at an 8.7, and I'm at an 8.4.
What the numbers would suggest, sometimes it makes it seem like I'm a fanboy more. I'm always going to like, I'm always going to think everything is great. But I don't think that's true. Do you?
I'm a bit more cynical, I think, than you are. But again, if we're now into 12 albums and you're at an 8.7 and I'm at an 8.4, if you were at a 9.5 and I was at a 7,
yeah,
then, but we're talking 0.3 of a point. I mean, that's a German judge having a bad day.
I also think the next two, which as far as I know, are going to be the last two that we do. I don't have any interest in reviewing Songs of Surrender.
Please, no.
I don't even want to. So, but the next two, I think, again, this is kind of tipping my hand, but I'm not going to be crazy about those two. We might find ourselves, you know, getting closer in the ratings.
Oh, I'm not going to tip my hand either, but I'm really not kind of rah-rah about the next one. You know, and then maybe if they release something in 2024, we'll come back in 2025. And
well, he'll do a whole episode on Atomic City.
Yeah, let's do that. Yeah. That's
So there you have it. No Line on the Horizon. Up next, Songs of Innocence. Rock and Roll Doggies. Yeah. Okay. So Don, take us out of here.
Thanks for logging in, folks, and listening to our thoughts on one of the most influential bands of the modern era. Please be sure to follow us at Rock and Roll Doggies on Instagram and on X at Roll Doggies for details about our next podcast and other tidbits as we take a chronological journey through the discography of U2. Until we connect again, good night, everybody.
No, it's a musical journey.